Glad to be here with Italian Julie and recently out Billy.
Hi.
Your characters have a kind of sketchy relationship to the truth, the Julie and Billy on screen. Do they see it as lying or just survival?
Wow, we're getting right into it. I expected there to be some pleasant... No, it's good. It's good.
Do they see it as lying or just surviving? I think they have their own warped perspective on things, right? I mean, Julie's the creator and the writer. She can speak to it.
No, but I think you're right. I think that we have the worldview of anything that we need to do to get what we want is justifiable. And at the same time, we have a distorted idea of the way things are.
Yeah.
In addition to that, this is sort of like a, you know, kind of a cop-out answer because it's sort of all of the above, but I think that our morals are very dubious, so, you know, we're way more comfortable lying than most people should be.
And I think, let's hear it for lying. I think that they are sharp about pop culture without being smart about their own lives. And I think that because of that, they make bad choices. So sometimes it's not about lying, it's just about they're not that bright sometimes.
Well, and it's funny because, like, yes, they're sharp about pop culture, but not about the business of it.
Of the business of show business.
And that's, they don't, I think, know, the biggest difference between, you know, us in real life and our characters is knowing how things work and then also being able to keep our heads down and actually doing the work, because our characters have not figured out that part of the equation yet.
That they're gonna have to really make something happen for themselves, right, and that the world is not gonna hand them anything.
And we're not good writers yet. Like,
right. I don't even know what Billy's good at.
No.
Like, professionally, I don't know.
I think we're talented, but we haven't done anything that would, like, get us a job yet.
Right.
Like, we haven't, like, put in the work to have something that's good enough to be like, oh yeah, no, you have the job.
They just see other people in their comedy circle or people that they hear about getting successful, and they think, why am I not on Saturday Night Live?
Yeah.
You know, it's without, like, actually
having an audition.
Doing a show that's worthy of getting you on Saturday Night Live.
Yeah. Or similarly, like, recapping a show and being like, why isn't anyone hiring me to be a TV writer? It's like, well, because you don't have a script. It's different.
Yeah.
One of the things that I think we all love about those characters is that they're so unfiltered. They just say whatever they think. Is there anything where you were creating the show or episodes where you didn't do something, where it went too far? Or you've got a lot of freedom on Hulu, but that some producer or someone said, no, you've crossed a line.
Oh, you mean like subjects that we wanted to cover that they were like, that's a little...
Right, subjects or a particular line or...
I mean, there's a lot of self-monitoring, and that's another thing that's different between us and the characters is, like, you know, we're almost overly thoughtful about every joke and every target, and things that we lose in the outline phase are different things we lose in the script phase are different than things we lose in, you know, production and then editing later. So we're very careful about what we, you know, what targets we pick, like the timing of it, the context of it.
Is there anything you can think of where you didn't do it?
Well, all right. Well, in the I'm gonna talk about the pilot and the Blue Ivy joke and where it, what we replaced.
Oh, okay. You all just got your money's worth. Is this free? I don't even know.
Well, and I feel liberated too, since Anthony Jeselnik, who's brilliant, had a lot of jokes about Eric Clapton's late son on his new, that really brought up the house, in his stand-up special. And originally the joke that my character tweeted was something about how, like, the acoustic version of Layla is so bad, like, I understand why his son threw himself out the window. Now, listen, here's a red flag, dead children. So we changed it, and nothing bad ever happened.
Let's give a little context. So, I mean, the whole, for those of you that haven't seen the pilot of Difficult People from the first season, the whole plot revolves around the fact that Julie's character, which is not Julie in real life, tweets something offensive about a celebrity and it blows up and she can't handle it. And that speaks to the flaws of the Julie character in the show. And And the whole story was about people hating her in the show because of an offensive tweet. So, of course, in real life, it ended up also happening, but with people who hadn't really seen the full episode probably and didn't understand the context, that was exactly what we were commenting on, that yeah. Julie's character and my character are always getting punished for doing these things.
And they're not the right things to do. Like, that's a tasteless, shitty joke. You shouldn't have made that joke. My character shouldn't have made that joke. You know, and I think that she would have been thrilled if it had had the same amount of attention, but it wasn't negative. Mm-hmm. The only thing that, like, convinced her to take it down or apologize, and all these, like, celebrity tweet apologies are all non-apologies anyway, was the backlash and, you know, that line about, you know, I like saying something crazy and then leaving the room. I don't like having a confrontation.
Right, exactly. And also, I did find it ironic, though, at that time with the Blue Ivy R. Kelly joke that did make it in place of the Eric Clapton joke, is that Julie got in more trouble for that joke than R. Kelly ever did in real life. Also, the balcony's empty, so there you go.
So maybe you could have brought a couple friends.
Yeah, we get it. It's a Sunday, but
yeah, it's hot outside. I understand.
Would have been nice.
So take us back a little bit, Julie. You were a writer and producer on Billy on the Street, Billy's other show, which I'm sure you all know. Were you friends before you got that job, or did you become friends when you? We're working on this show. How did that all happen?
We kind of discovered each other. I discovered Julie's writing online. There was a Tumblr situation years back. There was Tumblring going on, and there was blogging going on, and then I discovered her Twitter, and I hadn't heard of her except I had heard her name because we had both, my first TV job was a writing job on the third and final season of the show called The Big Gay Sketch Show on Logo, right? And it's nice to get a job. And so I wrote on the third season of that show, and the reason there was a slot open on that show to write on is because Julie had been writing on it the first two seasons and left. And so that's why I knew who Julie was, but we didn't really know each other. And then
I found Billy's videos online.
The Street YouTube videos before
yes,
I had a
before,
show.
Yes, before Billy had you know, real TV show, game show element of it. Like, he was just doing these Man on the Street videos that he would show at Ars Nova, and they were just so brilliant and like nothing I'd ever seen before. And I like wrote him a fan email and said, I love what you do, and I would just love to, you know, work with you at any point and get together and collaborate. And I was just crazy about his stuff. And so we got together and figured out like we wanted to work together and, you know, didn't really get anything off the ground as a lot of stuff like that happens. And then Billy got a show and called me and I wrote for him and we just got to know each other really well during the course of working together on Billy on the Street.
Yeah, and I've told this story before, but Julie was one of the first three people once Billy on the Street was like bought. We had a unique situation where we went straight to series. There was no pilot. The network, the first network, Billy on the Street, was on Fuse, took it straight to series. And Julie, I was like, oh shit, this is great, but now I have to actually go make a TV show. Who's gonna be involved besides me? And Julie was one of the, maybe the first, or definitely one of the first two or three people I contacted. And I remember sitting in the Starbucks, like near the Winter Garden, that Starbucks that's like open late. I would write there, and I was like emailing Julie. I was like, you don't understand, I got a TV show, I need you to work on it. It's starting right now. And thank God she did, so.
And when you devised Difficult People, what was your pitch to Billy? At what stage did you come up with it, and how did you tell him?
I was gonna write this script, I was gonna write a pilot script over the Christmas break, and I said, hey, I have an idea for sort of a Curb Your Enthusiasm style pilot where you're my best friend, and Billy was like, sure. I mean, there's really no lower stakes than telling your friend who's writing a spec, like, you want to be in the spec? Like, sure, yeah. You know, there's so many stages between then and when it actually becomes a thing. But I told him I was writing something for him, and he was into it. And by the time I had finished it and sent it to Amy, then you know, we sort of figured out what the show would be. So it
Amy
started
Poehler,
as a script.
Amy Poehler is one of the producers of the show.
Yes, Amy Poehler is one of the producers of the show.
Tell us a little more about some of the other characters and where they came from. Marilyn, Julie's mother, Andrea Martin.
Oh my God.
Is that based on anyone?
No, absolutely not. Certainly not my mother who's here tonight. Andrea Martin is so fucking good on the show. Like, you know, it started sort of with like a sketch of this character and sort of someone that Julie would like be afraid of becoming one day if she wasn't successful in show business, that there was this other path, whether it was like marrying someone or having to choose another industry that wasn't creative. And we sort of started from there. And then when we cast Andrea for the pilot, it was just like, all bets are off. We have this absolutely brilliant comedic actor, and we're just able to be inspired by her and write for her and just give her more and more and more to do. And it's just, what's that called? This, you know? You give me something,
like
I give you something.
Yeah, that. All right. And Arthur, dear Arthur, who is the perfect 50s wife, I think. James Urbaniak.
Yes.
Where does Arthur come from?
I was in a relationship at the time that I wrote the pilot, where I felt like I wasn't being very nice to my boyfriend at the time, and my career. And he certainly felt that my career was more important than our relationship, if you can imagine. Oh, boy. So, you know, I turned someone real into a cartoon, and here we are. No, you know what it is? I wrote that part specifically for James. I've always been a big fan of James, and he only gets to play creeps. Like, he plays, like,
true.
Pedophiles and, like... And it's not fair because he's just got so much range, and I just really like the idea of my character having this kind of like very patient, sort of the Cheryl Hines version mm-hmm. of someone that's like, why did you do that, Larry? And yet, you know, he sticks around, and maybe it's because she's just, you know, she's not boring, and maybe he really loves her. But I thought that would be like a important part of explaining who she was, as well as you know, figuring out how her situation, even her home life, isn't like great.
Do you work out backstories for those characters? We know, for instance, that Billy has a brother played by Fred Armisen. Do you have a whole history for Billy's family?
A lot of it comes from who he really is, and we have a lot of conversations about the differences between Billy Eichner and Billy Epstein. A lot of it is personal, and there's that growing edge of like, how intimate do we want to get? And that's a conversation.
Yeah. I will say, just for clarity, that my relationship with, I do have a half brother, an older half brother in real life. But my relationship with Fred on the show, Fred and my actual half-brother are nothing alike. And the tension between Fred and I on the show that's a fictional thing. But yeah, I mean, there are parallels. You know, it's like, there are a lot of things in the show where everyone's always like, how close are you to the characters? And there are some things that are very similar and some things that are not. And then there are some things that are somewhere in the middle.
But we ain't writing science fiction. You know?
Yeah, no, of course not.
It all comes from real life. It all comes from real experience. It all comes from situations that, you know, have made us feel a certain thing, and translate that into a different version of it or a funnier version of it.
What was the inspiration for this episode we just saw, the Italian Pinata episode?
Well, we knew that coming out day was gonna be a big part of it. And just how lame that is, and that, like, just the idea that it's like, I'll wait till October, you know, you're lying about, like, I should be true to myself, but October. So we wanted to have fun with that, and then there's this, you know, one of the fun things to write for Billy is, like, his contempt for a lot of gay culture, and his contempt for a certain kind of earnest gay man, and that resonates with coming out day, that resonates with you know, Mark Consuelos' character of being like pride rings or something that like you really need to wear. So we knew that that would be a fun thing to see Billy brush up against. And then at the same time, we were also talking about, the theme of that episode was like fake it to make it. We were like trying to figure out what Julie wants, and it was originally supposed to be like more of a season arc that I was looking for female friends. And I do think that that's something that we would definitely see more of. But coming from that sort of truthful place of Billy having contempt for this certain earnestness in the gay community and my character being like, why don't girls like me, are both very grounded ways for the two of us to wear like wigs and too much tanner and interact with like kooky town, like, you know, to get to like have that fun. And then there's also that like that Liza Minnelli thing that I like work backwards from, because I just always had a theory. Like I once met someone that called it a Frank Sinatra song and I was like, it's not, but okay. And so, you know, and also at the time, I mean, there was a lot of stuff that went into that. The Rachel Dolezal thing was, because we wrote it last summer, and we were, you know, she was more in the news then, not so much anymore.
I'm sensing a comeback, though. I hope.
Now's the time.
You're going to bring her back for this.
I hope so.
She should be your female friend.
Yes. Yes. No, I mean, honestly, like, that was the other thing. We were, like, so fascinated by Rachel Dolezal because she was so oblivious, and, like, she just was like, but I'm black. And you're just like, no, you can't do that. And that made me think of Julie. Like, that just seemed like something my character would be like, I'm Italian if I want to be. And it's like, no, you're not. And what you think is Italian is not Italian. So, yeah, there was a lot of that stuff going on.
And I like that on Difficult People, I mean, Julie really cares and is deeply passionate and knowledgeable about the gay community and all the nuances of and all the subcultures. I mean, she knows more about gay things than I do sometimes. And I'm like, how do you know about the like specifics of the and the nuances of the bear community and the cubs and the this and the that? Gay guys know what I'm talking about.
Oh, Bear Week was last week. Welcome back to everyone who's back from Bear Week.
I mean, Julie knows things about where gay guys go on
tough
vacation.
Re-entry.
And so, but I feel that there really aren't many shows on TV that deal with the gay community in a way that is not overly earnest, or just singularly cartoonish, right? There's very little middle ground. Even on shows that have attempted to show the gay community, it seems like they get scared.
Or
where everyone's walking on eggshells, and with Difficult People, we're not. You know, like, we obviously love gay people, but we can also make fun of them the way that we make fun of everyone else.
Well, a true misanthropist hates everyone equally. But I wanted to say there's also a third one where it's like earnest, cartoonish, and then there's the, like, he happens to be gay. Which is the, like, you have this totally generic character, but you just call him gay so that you don't need to explore what any of that means.
Mm-hmm. And there's what I love about this episode is that Julie picked up on something that happens between, not all, but can happen in gay relationships where you're more attractive the less gay you seem.
The mask for mask.
You know,
stuff.
Like the whole masculinity thing is played with in this episode where all of a sudden he's hot because people think he just came out and is leaving his wife. You know, like that makes him hotter, and that's not like the prettiest comment on how gay men are or are not attracted to each other, but it's a very valid, realistic observation.
And in addition to that, it's a fun excuse to like write what our characters would think straight guys would say.
Yeah, like he likes Hotel California. Like that's what I love that so much. Yeah.
I knew Hotel California and Big Lebowski were gonna be in that monologue somewhere. And then also just like Billy, it's also just like writing to, you know, it's writing to Billy's strengths. Like Billy doing that straight voice is hilarious.
Yeah, and it's fun for me to do it. It's fun to like be able to do other things. I mean, to find, you know, different personas to take on in the midst of Difficult People.
And to have the, like, you know, to have the privilege to make fun of this small group that you're in, instead of being reverent, which was our intention with Lola as well.
Mm-hmm. So one of the questions running through the whole series is, will poor Billy ever find true love? Because he goes through guy after
Not
guy
only through the series,
guy,
right? Karen.
I know there's one guy who could make you happy. His name is Oscar. The Academy Award.
Oh, the Academy Award. I was like, I don't think Oscar Isaac is gay.
Oh no, Oscar Eustace is gonna give you a run.
When Mike Daisy's done, you're gonna have you're gonna take over.
Diggs.
Yeah, exactly.
Was that always part of the idea that Julie would be the one with the stable relationship and Billy would just go through guy after guy and always find some fatal flaw?
Yes, and sometimes people write, I don't like when like, because we've seen gay guys on TV who are like, oh, like he's gonna be alone forever. But, and Billy is like lonely and single on the show, but is also fucking constantly. You know, like he's not at all one of these.
Sad sack, like.
What do you call it?
Celibate, like.
He's not celibate at all. You know, like he's just cannot connect sex and love. That's a different situation.
But that's a lot of people. That's not just gay men. That's not just people on television.
For sure.
I mean, I think that's a, you know, that's a realistic, you know, character trait.
Well, there is a lot of realism underneath the exaggeration. So I'm thinking, for instance, of the first episode where Billy hooks up with this guy in the steam room and then finds out he's this old-timey guy played by John
That's Lane. The most realistic thing that could ever happen.
But the realistic...
How many times that happened every... To you guys, sorry. Yes.
But the realistic part is there's always that moment when you think for a minute, oh, he's possible, and then you think, oh, no, no, there, now I've spotted
It's always something, yeah.
It's always something. And then he comes out in a derby hat.
Yeah. Or it's a participator or whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. There's always something. Do you go for that kind of realism, or do you just go for the humor and that takes care of itself?
Oh,
you know,
absolutely.
Sort of underlying emotional realism.
Absolutely start from a grounded place and then get to accessorize it with the sketch comedy that we know and love and that, you know, the jokes that we know and love. And, you know, I know we take a tremendous amount of pride in the fact that we are a hard comedy, that there are so many jokes. If you don't like that one, here's another one.
And that there are jokes at all.
Yeah.
And we talk about that in the show, even when we call out sort of this new genre of comedy that is not comedy.
Yeah.
And it's a genre that tends to win Emmys and things like that, yes. But it's not ultimately a comedy. And we wanted to make sure that there were jokes. And I think it's in a lot of the press that's getting written about the show, and it's been very well received for the most part, but it's so weird that there's a show with jokes that everyone kind of ignores the emotional life of the characters. Like almost every review that's written, and a lot of them are positive, thankfully, but they're still like, wow, like this show has jokes. Like they wear it on its sleeve that there are jokes.
Yeah, they're not ashamed at all.
They're not ashamed of being like a comedy, but to the point where I think not a lot is being discussed regarding the emotional lives of the characters, and I think that the show would not work unless you believed what was happening, because Just Jokes is not a show. It's a good title, though, Just Jokes. I think that...
The center wouldn't hold.
Right.
I mean, I think of Ab Fab as, like, a good example of a friendship love story, and that show, for me, I mean, it's so fabulous, and, like, And I just remember, you know, when I was watching, when they first started airing those in America, like that scene where, you know, she picks her up from the roof on the helicopter. Like, I remember getting, like, teary. And that's as crazy as stuff gets, like, that is something that people are going to be on board with because it's true.
In the show, both your characters would give anything to be famous, but you've both become more famous over the past couple of years. Does that change the way people react to you on the street, for example? Do you?
Well, speaking of the street.
Yes.
Billy's a lot more famous than I am, but I don't believe that that anyone knows me, so it's still very surprising to me when people do say something,
Billy on the
but I
been
love it. Sorry.
Right. Stepped on your joke.
Yes. No, it wasn't a joke.
Well, yeah, Billy on the Street's been around longer. We're shooting our fifth season right now, and there were videos before that, and thank you. And Julie was, of course, a big part of that, but wasn't on camera. And so Difficult People only had 8 episodes the first time, and so people, you know, you'll, yeah. I think that you know, we're famous, but not famous.
The right people like us, first of all.
Yeah, we're famous.
Which is the best part of being cult, is people come up to you and you're not like, oh boy. But the other thing to that point is another character differentiation and similarity, which is that Billy Epstein and Julie Kessler do not have a TV show. However, I, just speaking for myself, they could have one and they would never be satisfied, or they would never be happy.
Right.
It would never be enough. And that's something that, you know, I work on as a human being. But as far as they're concerned, it's important to, as the seasons go on, for them to have these little wins. So they're not on a treadmill. They could advance. The opportunities get bigger as they go forward. They just have to screw them up in different ways. Or the opportunities fall apart for reasons that we're learning as we go, because the world around the Difficult People stars is, in addition to them being awful, is also a terrible place.
So, well, it's New York. Do you have a particular vision of New York? Because there are all these fantasy visions of New York that TV shows have. What is yours?
What's our fantasy?
Your vision of New York for the show.
For the show?
Is it realistic or...
Well, it's very specific, and that's a lot about our humor, is that, like, there's a lot of references people don't get. Mm-hmm. And, you know, sometimes that matters, and sometimes I don't give a shit. And the David Byrne... Oh, my God!
Who was that?
So glad a straight white man made an appearance. Can't we have anything?
Now it's a comedy. I think this just got nominated for an Emmy. The David Byrne thing from the first season was important to me, because anyone who's lived in New York has seen David Byrne ride around on a bicycle and has wondered what it would be like if he was hit by a car. And I love David Byrne. I'm telling you, the Talking Heads are probably my favorite band, but that just tickled me, and that was just something I was compelled to put in. But yeah, it's noisy, it's obnoxious, everybody's like, you know, cranky and...
I really like how small my apartment is on the show. And I think it was a very specific choice, but he would rather live in literally a closet than live in Brooklyn or Queens.
Yeah.
And I, as someone who grew up in Queens, I feel the same way. You know, it's all perspective, and, you know, they still, you know, there's that very nuanced New York thing where you're like, I deserve to live in Manhattan, you know, like, and I will, even if I have no space.
And the great thing about New York is that we fit in. Like, everybody here is like completely impatient, and there's a, you know, not to give away too much of our finale, but, you know, there's like a terror alert related plot about not taking the subways, and mm-hmm. at a certain point we're like, we're New Yorkers, we take the fucking subways. And, you know, maybe that's not gonna be the most relatable thing to everybody in the country who watches the show, but I mm-hmm. think it embodies a certain attitude that is either relatable or fun to watch.
So we have some questions from the audience, and this one actually is a question that I was curious about too. This is, how did you choose the guest for season 2? But my question also is, what usually comes first, the character or the guest? Because you've got you've had a lot of guests last season, Seth Meyers, Fred Armisen this season, you've had Nathan Lane so far, Tina Fey. Do you say, oh, we have a gay prostitute, let's call Seth Meyers?
That definitely happens.
That's exactly what happened.
Really? That's what happened?
Well, yeah. they write the scripts, and then I think everyone sort of sits down as like, who would be fun in this role? I don't think the goal is, let's hire as many celebrities as we can. But if it makes sense, you know,
we've turned down people that are like, people pitched us and we're just like, nope, doesn't make sense.
It's got to make sense for the show. There's got to be the right character.
Yeah.
I thought it's specifically about the prostitute in the first season, we thought, like, who could play, if it was gonna be a well-known person playing that role, who would be surprising? Who's gonna come on screen and you're never gonna think they're like a seedy, like, gay prostitute? And I thought, Seth Meyers.
Yeah, that was Billy. Honestly, that was Billy's casting idea, and it was so brilliant. It just like blew, it, I mean.
And Amy Poehler and Seth Meyers are very close friends, and Amy said, he's not gonna do that. It's like not what Seth does. And I was like, let me just email him. And I did, and he did it. And what makes that work is that you would never expect that behavior from Seth Meyers, like asking me to go jerk off behind a tree. I should be so lucky.
Email him again, you never know.
What was that?
I said, email him again, you never know.
I will.
Now he's married to that lawyer, the whole thing.
You know what, Karen? I will.
But I also think, yeah, like casting, not against type as much as like what would be fun to mm-hmm. see, you know? Like, I've never seen Nathan Lane stick his hand in the toilet. Like, I thought, you know, the Nathan, and by the way, the broader answer is both. Like, we think of ideas for actors we know are interested. In the case of Joel McHale, he was a fan of the show and a friend of Billy's, and so we wrote a part for him. In the example of Tina Fey, it was just like, oh no, she has to play herself, and it's gonna be really great to watch her and Andrea Martin have a scene together and, you know, her character not know who she is. But but with the Nathan thing, have you guys seen the episode, the Nathan episode? I won't give it away for those who haven't, but something really terrible happens to him.
Yeah, worse than sticking his hand in his
toilet.
Yes,
yes. Right. And for that, we just sort of figured who would be like a really irreplaceable actor? Like, who would be someone that like, it would be a giant loss if this person were not around.
And there's a little bit of reality in, you know, Julie and I are walking down the street in New York and we run into Nathan Lane. You know, that's within the world.
And we actually do like him. And that's also rare for our characters to mm-hmm. be like, well, not rare, because I think we love who we love. But yeah, no, he had to be, he was a very good sport.
And who else do you have coming up? You have Lin-Manuel Miranda,
yes.
among other guests this yes. season. Is that a musical episode?
Yes.
It's not, no.
No.
Not a full musical.
But there is music in it.
There are musical numbers, and it's one of my favorites.
You know, we were doing that, and it was maybe like 30 seconds of music altogether, but like me and Billy and Cole were just like, we love doing this more than anything.
We were like, oh, right, we just want to be in place.
We're in silly costumes, and yeah.
And you sing and dance?
We sing and dance, and it's wonderful, and it's very brief, so you don't like get sick of it, but.
Can you give us a little 10-second sample?
No.
Singing? No.
No.
Absolutely.
No, because you have to see it.
The arrangement is important. It's very, like, okay. It's a tribute to Hamilton, but not, like, our tribute's, like, better than other tributes.
Okay. And you know Lin-Manuel from your early days, right?
Yeah. He's my dad.
He's your dad.
Make any sense. It doesn't make any sense. Why are you laughing? It doesn't make any sense. I know Lin-Manuel. I know Lin-Manuel Miranda because he had this was about 10 years ago. I was doing a live show called Creation Nation at Ars Nova and Joe's Pub. And this is a place where actually you might have heard of that, yeah. We pretty much only did it in New York at some comedy festivals, and that's where I kind of developed the Billy on the Street persona. We would show men on the street videos in that live show, and that's where that whole thing started. And Lin has a hip-hop improv group called Freestyle Love Supreme, right, which David Diggs was also in, and that's how they knew each other. And we would just perform in the same theaters. They would always perform at Ars Nova, Joe's Pub.
Drama Bookshop downstairs.
In the basement of the Drama Bookshop.
Comedy shows.
Like, that's where I saw Lin perform. He did a workshop of In the Heights where he played all the characters by himself. to like figure out what was working and what was not. This is a long time ago. And so I knew Lynn from then, and we've always crossed paths, and he was very nice. He came and did this for us, and he filmed with us very early in the morning, right at, like, the morning after he had won and performed on the Grammys. He woke up at like 5 a.m. to do this
with us. He found time for us, and he was really sweet.
But you had to buy scalper tickets for Hamilton. How did that happen?
All right, you know. Once upon a time, Hamilton wasn't like, you know, you could still get tickets, I think. And so I didn't, and I went on Craigslist, and I bought fake tickets, Karen, and
Well, I just wondered why his friend Lynn didn't give you tickets, but that's a different question.
Well, he ended up giving me tickets, and he's my friend too, Karen.
Okay,
and you know.
But he's.
You know, I auditioned for Freestyle Love Supreme. I didn't get a call back, but I thought my rapping was pretty good.
But Julie and I do rap when we do our musical thing.
Ah, okay.
What things to look forward to.
But anyway, yes, I did get scammed, and then he was very sweet. He you know, I paid for them. They were house tickets, but. I ended up sitting next to Therese Hines Carey.
Did she like it?
She had no idea what was going on. I think she thought she was at Cats. She had sunglasses on the whole time. She reeked of ketchup money. It was fabulous.
Okay, I'm gonna read this one specifically because I wouldn't make this one up. As two people who work their asses off to achieve the goals, what do you say to the young Jew who wants to follow in your steps? It's very specific.
Well, one thing is don't lean on your Jewishness because we're all that way. You're not special. Keep your head down. Keep your head down and do your work. You know, like,
yeah.
I think it's really, you know, I don't think it's useless to schmooze. I think it's fun. I think it's good to be social and have relationships, but ultimately, if you don't have anything to show the people with whom you have relationships, you're like everybody else. I mean, you just have to like do the very lonely, boring work of staring at a blank computer screen or isolating yourself and or getting a production together and learning how to edit and just stuff
that
isn't fun.
You gotta do the work. Yeah, you have to make sacrifices. You need discipline. It's hard. I found myself talking myself out of a lot of things early on. Like, Billy on the Street would be a good TV show. Oh, no, it wouldn't. Here's 10 reasons why it won't work. And then everyone kind of agrees with you. And then I had that idea for years before I actually thought, all right, maybe it's worth trying to, like, put a sizzle reel together to show people how it would work. And, of course, then the relationships that you have matter. It helped that Funny or Die wanted to help me out.
But eventually, not right away.
There had been many production companies before Funny or Die that I wanted their help to create a Billy on the Street sizzle reel that would not do it. And you have to, like, keep going. Like, it sounds so cheesy, but perseverance is the name. Perseverance and talent. Not letting rejection get to you.
Yeah,
it's all the name of the game.
Yeah.
And also, if you could look hot.
Yeah.
That's also really good. If you can, you know, we're trying.
Another callback I didn't get was Mike and Dave need, what is it?
Wedding
dates.
Oh, I thought Mike and Dave needed a script. But I...
You know, none of us will ever know.
I'm kidding. A movie I auditioned for and did not get. So there you go.
You're more of a Dave, but I could
thought
also
I was a
see
Mike,
you reading
bro.
For Mike.
Well, here's another very specific question. I think this is for you, Billy. Where can I purchase the Brokeback Mountain-themed oven mitts featured in the Billy on the Street episode Latina Faye?
Oh, yeah. You can't. You can't purchase them. What?
Flip them off.
Why don't you make them like we did? Make your own. Thank you for watching the show. I appreciate it.
So what is the biggest difference between the Billy Epstein character and the Billy on the Street character?
A lot of differences. Billy on the Street is a cartoon. Mm-hmm. You know, I've always thought of it as a live-action cartoon. When I was growing up, I was obsessed with Pee-wee Herman and Pee-wee's Playhouse. Like, it's like religious. to me. And so Billy on the Street was in that is in that Pee Wee Herman world. He's not a character. He's not a developed character. There's no emotional life. It's a persona. It's a joke. And I think with what has been so wonderful for me, there have been many wonderful things about Difficult People, but one of them is that Julie knew me as a person. Because you can talk about your acting background forever. I went to Northwestern. I was a theater major. I'm an actor, guys. But you need someone who knows you, who in this case also happens to be a genius writer, who is willing to trust you to create an actual person. And I think that on Difficult People, we're really working hard to make both Billy and Julie fully fleshed out, three-dimensional characters. And you know, they have their exaggerated moments for comic effect. But he has an emotional life, and he's dealing with family and friends and dating and love and things that Billy on the Street, that has no place in that world.
And I just wanted to say that it's just such a, at the risk of being cheesy, it's such a privilege to have Billy trust me to put things in his voice. And that's something that is so vulnerable as someone that writes stuff for themselves. And it's a conversation. By no means is it like an isolated process, but it's definitely, it's an intimacy that, you know, hopefully shows up in his performance and the stuff that we give him to do and the different levels, and, you know, helps that he can act. He's capable of it. It's not like he's a cartoon in real life.
And I think there's no vulnerability in Billy on the Street. There's no place for that. That's like 100% entitlement. I'm right, you're wrong, this is my world. I will invade your personal space and own it.
And the vulnerability, you know, Poehler like has given, and I really, she's not here right now, but I cannot express how huge of a contribution she is to just every episode and the whole series and the tone and every joke and every cut. But one of the concepts of the philosophies that was so important to her going into it was vulnerability. And she would always flag things, especially for my character, where I seemed bemused. That was like something to watch out for. And it's important to see my character eat shit. It's important for her to want to crawl into her skin sometimes, and it's not all about having a snappy comeback right away, because that's not how people are. When we do have snappy comebacks, they're fucking brilliant, but you know.
So I'm not sure I buy the premise of this question, but David wonders, I realize you dislike most celebrities. Are there any you like?
You know, we love celebrities, David.
We are celebrities. David.
And Diane Wiest.
Obviously. You know, we love a lot of people. We just don't necessarily gravitate towards like
Taylor Swift,
like, the
Kanye
person
West.
Of the moment.
You're not gonna find like, you know, we have nothing to say about Kanye. It's like the one of the things that connected us to each other is our love, not even obscure celebrities, it's just like...
Talented people.
Talented people, that's one way of putting it.
And also, adults. Julie and I have been adults since we were children. Right? I mean, I didn't know her as a child, so I shouldn't say that, but like,
reading the trades when like...
I always felt 40, you know? Like, I always felt like I was 40 years old.
I remember seeing Hannah and her sisters and being like, that's what I want. Yeah. I was like 10.
Not even to make the movie, to be one of the characters in the movie, who I now realize are miserable and all cheating on each other. And it's terrible, but it still felt like compelling and glamorous.
Were you funny as kids, both of you?
What was that?
Were you funny as kids?
When I wasn't in pain.
I was not a pained child, actually.
Back to my pain. I was definitely funny, but I wasn't like socially, like I was by no means like the class clown. Like there was no like, oh, this is my group of friends and I'm gonna crack them up with impressions of the teacher. No, it was just more about like sitting there and like thinking of like a brilliant put down that I would never use.
I guess I was funny. Yeah, but I didn't realize it till like high school, college, people started laughing. I would ad-lib things, and I was like, oh, I guess I'm funny. But, yeah.
So we have time for one last question. This is for both of you. What are the biggest lessons you've learned about having creative control over difficult people or Billy on the street?
That you're just so spoiled. I mean, it can't get better. Like, I mean, it's, yeah, it's, I just speaking from personal experience with Hulu, they have let us make the show we wanted and want to make. I mean, throughout the entire process, from the script to the pilot to the series to every episode, their notes are either helpful, or if they don't work, we talk it through and we end up doing what we wanted to do. And it, honestly, it's such a, I'm just so lucky to have that. And I think that when they bought it, they knew, you know, we had the advantage of having already made a pilot for USA, so that we had a better, you know, example of like, this is the show we want to make. But to actually have the opportunity to have somebody be like, oh yeah, no, that's the show I want, and keep doing that, I mean, like, it's like winning the lottery.
And what about Billy on the street?
What was the question?
What have you learned about creative control?
It's the greatest thing ever. It spoils you. It's hard to imagine not having it once you have it. And also, it is an insane, exhausting level of responsibility.
Yeah.
And it's, you're not supposed to complain. If you're on television, you're not allowed to complain.
You can complain
about
to each other. Like,
you can complain to each other.
I had brunch with Genji. That was nice. Genji Kohan and I were like, yeah, I'm yeah, not, yeah. They're like, oh, I can't complain. They're like, oh, yes, I can.
Yes, you can complain amongst your peers, but you can't, yeah. You know, I don't want to, you can't sit on stage and be like, oh, my life.
But it's fucking exhausting.
Yeah, it's a shitload of work, and it's just an unbelievable amount of work. And you have to be, and I'm very glad in my mid-20s when, people were, TV execs and big agents were coming to my live shows here in New York. And I had brushes with getting TV shows of my own at that point. And I was like 27, 28 years old. And it didn't happen. And then things got very quiet until my videos started going viral. And I was at that point 33 years old, 34. And I'm very glad that Billy on the Street happened in my mid-30s as opposed to my mid-20s. Had it happened in my mid-20s and I had that much power, I would have been a fucking asshole. I wouldn't have had the discipline. I don't think the show would have been as good. I would have spent all my money and just been a total idiot about the whole thing.
It's also like, as control, yeah, I don't want to say control freaks, because anybody who's an artist who cares about what they do is going to be invested in the control of it. There's a learning curve to the trust of it all and the delegating of it all, and to find partners that you trust, and that you, like, you know, I'm very lucky to have Scott King, our showrunner, mm-hmm. who's on set when I can't be, and I completely trust him to make something work if it's not working, or text me and we'll figure it out. But, like, that's a skill that, you know, was a big trust fall, honestly, and I agree. I don't know if I could have done that in my 20s.
Well, you're both working a lot, and we have to end because Billy has to run off to do Watch What Happens
with
Live.
Jacqueline Larita. Yes. Let's give it up for Jacqueline Larita.
But thank you both so much for being here. This has been great.
Thanks, Karen.
Thank you for coming.